10 here, our first half stats. Interesting, Todd, that Cincinnati still outgaining West Virginia 247 to 231.
Yeah, they really played pretty well in the first half, except for right at the end. And that's where the game kind of slipped away, right at the end against West Virginia. Pat White took advantage of a little bit of a relaxation on the Cincinnati defense. And that's why I think now, this first possession of the third quarter, West Virginia gets a football. Cincinnati's defense has to really rise up and make a stop.
When Cincinnati gets the ball back, do you see them coming out and trying to attack downfield? That was what they wanted to do when the game started.
I think they have to. I think West Virginia is still playing a lot of that cover two. There's some seams down the middle of the field or out on the sideline. They just got to do a better job of catching the football.
All right, Cincinnati will have to kick it away to start the third quarter. Mountaineers are up 21 to 10. And they're listening for scores to be announced as well, with Oklahoma losing. Divine upended, spilled as he got over the 15-yard line, and Pat White, first half.
Yeah, had an excellent first half. He did what he does, and that's run. He ran for two touchdowns, 74 yards. He also completed 9 of 11 passes. A lot of them were short throws. It got out of his hand quickly. But you just can't relax against the guy. I mean, he's got too much speed as a runner. He plays with poise. He plays with confidence. And right there at the end of the first half, he really made his presence felt.
Jardy has 180 yards in total offense first half.
Very important drive right here for Cincinnati. They had a chance to
After a really silly delay, we'll start from the 17-yard line. Slayton and Schmidt beside White. White on the keeper. He just makes people miss so effortlessly.
Well, part of that is vision. I mean, if you want to be a great runner, an open field runner, you've got to have great vision. And Pat White has that kind of vision. He knows where the defenders are, and it's just a little stop and start. I mean, you can't fault Anthony Hoke. He was in the right position. He kept leverage, but he couldn't make the play.
That's the third time he has reached out tonight for Patrick White and got nothing but air.
I know he's skinny, but I didn't know he was invisible.
White, quick throw to Reynaud. Swarmed under as he got to the 30. And that's enough for a first down. D'Angelo Smith up from the corner. And Angelo Craig, number 82, chased it down from defensive end.
Angelo Craig is an interesting guy. He came to Cincinnati as a wide receiver. He's got great speed, and his stock has really started to rise this year as a defensive end. He's 6'5", 245 pounds with 4.5 speed. He's got a future as a defensive end in the NFL because he's got that speed off the edge.
Slayton.
There he is right there, chasing the play from the backside. You see the closing speed of a pretty big athlete. There's D'Angelo Craig coming from the backside, a flat course to the football, and just closes on it. I mean, I'm sure Steve Slayton is not used to be tackling from behind by a defensive lineman.
Pretty good job for a guy who's in his first year as a starter. Second and 8. White straight ahead. A lot of times, this is a very simple offense. Snap it to Patrick White, and he runs straight in the offseason, and they try to pick his mind about this spread offense. This is the thing now in college football.
And not just college guys. Norm Chow came from the Tennessee Titans because he's got a quarterback in Vince Young, who's a mobile guy as well.
Pressure on White. What a great fake. Gets out of bounds. Just a little shake of the hip, and people literally fall on their face trying to chase this guy down.
To the open side of the field.
Another first down for the Mountaineers at their own 45. White dives forward for about 4. Terrell Byrd, number 95, made another tackle.
That's how he got that zone read on the defensive end, and everything blossomed from there. It was an accident.
Well, sometimes the best thing that happened is looking at it from a different perspective, and accidents will do that. Slayton, nice move on his part to get to the outside. And Slayton on a play that could have lost a couple of yards, picks up three or four. Rodriguez did not have the benefit that other coaches have had.
Virginia, a lot of quarterback run is a part of part and parcel of this offense.
Third and two, White throws for it, incomplete. Gonzalez had to dive for it. Nakamura, who's a pretty good kick returner, back at the 10-yard line. Low line drive kick. Nakamura has to let it go inside the 10.
I think it hit a West Virginia coverage man a little bit before they. Of course, Dennis Dixon was on that list, but the knee injury kind of takes him out of it, unfortunately, because he was having a great year.
Cincinnati with no success on the ground. Jacob Ramsey is mugged as he gets the carry on first down.
Just going back to the Heisman thing, I mean, it's been an interesting year because it's still wide open. I mean, it's going to go all the way down to the final weekend of the season, just like this whole season has been. The whole season is going to go down to December 1st. The games that are decided, you know, who's going to play in the national championship, we're not going to know any of that until that last weekend.
It's really been a reflection of the season itself.
Yeah.
Mock is going to take it on a quarterback draw, and Morty Ivey made the tackle, along with Magro. It's interesting how some guys have shown up in the Heisman race for a couple of weeks, and then their team plays so badly in an upset, they're gone. Or like Dennis Dixon, he gets hurt, and that probably crippled his chances.
Yeah, it really did. I mean, again, he was probably the front runner, quite honestly. And if Oregon would have kept, and if he stays healthy, I don't think there's any way Arizona beats them in that game the other night. But neither one happened.
Third and five for Mock under pressure. Throws to the sideline. What a throw. What a catch.
On the move, just what Rich Rodriguez said. We've got to do a better job of containing that quarterback when he scrambles. And he threw a perfect throw to Dominic Goodman on the sideline.
Oh, what a grab.
Wow. Dominic Goodman was an outstanding high school quarterback. Played at Colerain High School. Won a state championship. Here's a crazy formation for Cincinnati.
And to try to make something out of a trick play, they throw for Barnett. He's covered by Reed Williams, and the middle linebacker.
The line never moved. Johnny Dingle's asking his Cincinnati sideline, what was that? What are you guys doing here? The whole line is over here. Now, none of those guys are going to move. Here's the center snapping to the quarterback. Actually, it's the tight end, I think, snapping to the quarterback. Ernest Jackson, number 14, he snaps and goes out. This is like something you draw up in the backyard.
I saw this in high school.
Yeah?
Yeah.
You mean when you played? I saw it
in high school. Right down the middle of Barnett again between four defenders.
Well, we saw that the first play of the game for Cincinnati, but they dropped it. This time, Barnett hangs on to it in a whole bunch of traffic. Down the middle against cover two. That's a soft area. West Virginia's in position, but the linebacker, Reed Williams, number 47, didn't know where the football was. And Ben Mock threw a perfect throw. And then his receiver, Barnett, held on to it when he got pummeled at the end of the catch.
Barnett, four catches, 149 yards. And Mock has really been impressive. Wants to throw again. This time goes out in the flat. Barnett makes a move to get away. Cuts back inside. Drilled as he got inside the 20.
I got to tell you something about this Barnett. Now, he's listed at 6'4". I don't know, 175 pounds. He's 155, 160 soaking wet. I'm at practice Thursday, and it is freezing here. And he's in shorts and a T-shirt and his shoulder pads and jersey. Everybody else has got sweats on. They got gloves. He's out there, 165, 70 pounds, in T-shirt and shorts. Like, this guy is not right.
He's got some skill, too, and they throw for him again. He is wide open, and they are just torching this secondary again.
Little combination route, and Barnett comes out on the sideline. It's a little wheel route and a hitch to draw the coverage up, and Ben Mock is right on it. I mean, he's seeing it, and he's putting the ball where it needs to be.
How are guys this open?
I can't answer that.
Greg Moore has checked in as the running back. Spot the ball at the 7. Mott wants to throw again. It takes off. Lost the ball. And the Mountaineers got it.
Boy, what a costly turnover for Ben Mott. His second fumble of the ball game. They had great momentum. Their strength this year has been turnover margin, one of the best in the country, the best in the Big East, forcing turnovers and protecting it on theirs. He dropped that before the defense even got to him.
He was trying to shift it away from Keelan Dykes. Dykes pounced on the ball.
Yeah, he just tried to put it away. Dykes didn't even get a hand on it, but Dykes comes up with the fumble recovery for West Virginia.
That is a monster turnover. They really had the momentum going with that passing game.
Yep.
So West Virginia takes over now at its own 13. Devine, the freshman.
20.
Yikes. 27-7? It is great for West Virginia. Yeah. They were celebrating after Oregon won on Thursday night. Now two of the top four going down in front of them. Another step closer to a national championship shot if they can win the next 3 weeks.
Yep.
They play Connecticut next week, Pitt the week after that. Both of those are at home.
Another team that's pretty happy.
More.
You're right.
And boys, there have been help galore this year. Every time teams need three people above them to lose, they do.
Another big third down for the Cincinnati defense. Can they respond after the turnover?
You can't leave this defense out there forever. They're going to get torched. Itself right out of it. First down, Mountaineers at the 27. Slayton to the 34. Ball came out, but after he was down, and he was stopped by Cedric Tolbert to back up strong safety.
You know, we really talked about when we talked about this, the football, that's when they've had problems this year. Well, it's been the Cincinnati turnovers that have really hurt their cause tonight. You can't play a team as good as West Virginia and give away opportunities and give away the football. And that's what they've done so far tonight.
White, straight ahead. No, you're not going to stop them all the time.
No.
And if you give them extra possessions, you're just asking for it. Here's Holly.
Well, guys, a lot of emotions roiling on this Cincinnati bench right now. Ben Mock sitting on the sideline, very quiet, and trying to explain to his backup quarterbacks what went wrong on that. He keeps shaking his head. He thinks maybe he lost the ball while he was trying to do a juke move, and he just keeps shaking his head. He's very quiet. But, guys, Barnett, who just had all those great catches to get them in scoring position, just went nuts. Threw the water bottle. The phone went flying. He's very frustrated.
I can imagine, because, Holly, he has turned in a great performance tonight. Slayton. You just get the feeling these guys are one step away from a 70-yard run every time they have the ball.
And I tell you, I just saw something, too, that is impressive with West Virginia. I saw a wide receiver, Darrell Jala, just going downfield about 15 yards and taking the safety out on that play. These wide receivers, they know with this offense, with Steve Slayton and Patrick White, the way they run the football, if we get a block downfield, it can be a 60 or 70-yard run at any time.
And all three of the guys that play a lot have been tenacious in that department. Slayton. It's already number 3 all-time in West Virginia rushing. He's going to put in his paperwork for the NFL. He wants to see where he stands, if he is in the first half projected of the draft. He may go. Otherwise, he will probably come back. And what a return that would be, with Slayton as a senior and White as a senior, if he comes back.
And Devine as a sophomore. And a couple of these other receivers who are freshmen.
Schmidt is the only senior starter on offense, and if that doesn't scare defensive coordinators to death, I don't know what would. Slayton again. Drilled out of bounds by Nakamura, who's an outstanding safety. And a nice kid, a very bright young man.
He's a leading tackler on this team. He's been a longtime starter. You know, he's a safety that the Cincinnati coaches like to get around the football because he's an excellent tackler. He has a nose for the ball. He makes a lot of big plays, strips the football really well. Seven tackles tonight. I mean, he's not a safety that you're going to see playing deep down the middle of the field as much as you're seeing him around the football.
West Virginia is just starting to pound the Cincinnati defense. Before that play, the last seven carries had gone for 7, 7, 7, 5, 5, 5, and 7. Let's go to Holland.
Well, guys, you saw the big hit Haruki Nakamura just put on, and it's a miracle he's even playing football. He grew up with a father who was a judo coach, but when his father died when he was 5 years old, his older brother took pity on him and said, I'm going to sneak you into football. You just can't tell mom. Mom saw him going out of the house with pads one day, guys, and she finally relented, but it's a miracle he's even getting to play.
Well, he said he would have been, he and his brother, there goes Slayton. He's got some power, too. Nakamura, one of the guys he's dragging with him along with Anthony Williams. And there's a flag down back upfield.
Yeah, Mike Dent, the center, number 68, appears to be the guilty party on this one.
And that's a big, tough run by Slayton. It'll come back. But back to Nakamura, he and his brother would have been training for the Olympics day in and day out. They were, their heritage in judo was that good.
Yeah, boy, his dad was an...
And she wasn't scratching him with it either. Mountaineers moved way back to the Cincinnati 47. Here goes White.
Yeah, they're just driving on it right now.
Yeah.
And it's, and you look at the body language of the Cincinnati defense. Slower getting up off the ground. They've lost a little bounce in their step. And this West Virginia offense, Pat White limping a little bit at the end of that play.
He's been very active tonight. It's the last thing the Mountaineers could afford. The only game they lost, South Florida, one of the reasons they lost it was Pat White was injured.
I bet he doesn't run it on this one. I think Rich Rodriguez saw him limping a little bit. I bet he gives the football to someone else on this play.
Schmidt. Throw a bone to the big guy. Adam Hoppel made the tackle. And Pat White, who had rushed for 803 yards this season coming into this one, has picked up another 121, a career high 24 carries. He's only two away from that.
We had 147 yards rushing last week against Louisville, including the game-winning 50-yard touchdown run at the very end. And he is just a dynamic, dynamic runner. Speed and vision.
Third and 7. Cincinnati comes with the blitz. White unloads. Slayton out of the backfield. Never saw it. Nakamura with good coverage.
Nice
and
job.
White
by,
got dumped for his trouble.
Yep. Nice job by Cincinnati. They're a zone team, but they said, hey, we got to go after Pat White, and we'll take our chances playing man and hope we can get to the quarterback before he can make an accurate throw, and they do.
That was a stand that Cincinnati had to have.
Absolutely. Had to. West Virginia going to go for it here on fourth down. Too far for a field goal. One more time, Cincinnati. Last time they brought pressure and played man. They're lining up in zero man coverage again, it looks like.
They thought they'd have stopped him. Now they got to do it again. Blitz coming. White over the middle, incomplete. It's 21-10. Great aerial shots tonight, courtesy of Outback Steakhouse. Look for the Bloomin' Onion 1 at sporting events throughout the year. Cincinnati has made a big defensive stop and have the ball back. They could not afford to let West Virginia have another touchdown.
Yeah, they fooled West Virginia on the coverage on that fourth down play. Pat White very upset with the results on fourth down.
Mark, good protection. Now he's flushed. And throws, almost intercepted. Lewis had a shot at it and couldn't hold it.
Let's go back and see why Pat White was so upset with Will Johnson, his freshman wide receiver. He's going to run a post, but Cincinnati is going to drop a linebacker underneath there after showing blitz, and it looks like man, but it's really not. Corey Smith, number 42, is going to drop underneath it, and when Will Johnson saw that, he slowed down. He stopped on the route,
Pat White wanted him to continue to run right through that, and he threw the ball to the spot that he wanted Johnson to be. Just a miscommunication with a young receiver.
And that's why quarterbacks get interceptions and look bad when it wasn't their fault. Mock trying to take off again. He's in trouble, and down he goes. Dingle just would not give up and finally got him and dragged him down.
And credit downfield to the West Virginia secondary. They've not done a very good job tonight of staying with their receivers when Ben Mock has scrambled out of the pocket. That time, Ben Mock nowhere to go with the football, and he ends up taking the sack on second down.
Dingle now with 8 sacks on the season. He's the Mountaineer leader. 6'3", 270-pound senior.
The worst part about that sack is now we're third and very long. Chances are the Cincinnati defense, which is fatigued, is going to have to come right back on the field.
3-man rush. Mott goes on the quarterback draw. That's sort of an odd call in that situation. He is not Pat White. He is mobile, but he's not going to get you 20 yards very often.
Third and very long. The sack on second down was just a killer for the Cincinnati offense. Because your defense, they barely got a half a Gatorade in their gullet on the sideline on that one.
Rivers will go back to his own 20-yard line. Huber, who leads the nation in punting at 46-7, will kick it away. Clock running as we approach a minute. Spiral, but returnable. Rivers. Spun down at the 33-yard line. 14-yard return after a 51-yard punt, and the Heisman candidate will bring the offense back on the field with 57 seconds to go third.
Good as anybody.
You're right.
Jackson was special.
Well, Jackson, before he hurt his hip, was virtually unstoppable. He looked so much. He ran like a guy who was a 250-pound fullback who could just crush people, and yet he'd crush one and outrun the next.
Yeah.
Frightening.
I remember when he was also doing the baseball thing and playing with the Royals.
Yeah.
I was in Kansas City with the Chiefs at the time, and he'd strike out and break that bat over his thigh.
Wasn't that something?
That was impressive in and of its own.
Last time West Virginia had the ball, they went 6 minutes, took a lot of time off the clock, but did not score.
Well, that's a tough little play right there to defend.
Isn't it?
Because Pat White is, it's kind of a play-action fake. He's faking like he's going to run, and then he steps back off the line and flips it out to Reynaud. And then you've got to tackle him out in space.
Little variation on the Tebow fake.
Yeah, that's right. We'll call that the White fake.
They let the clock tick down, and we'll go to the fourth quarter with the Mountaineers on top by 11.